Hello, welcome to episode number 14, that is November episode of Curiosity the Science Show. What did I learn in October of 2020? So as usual, this episode covers topics across the discipline including human microevolution, COVID-19, gratitude, tinnitus, wilderness, dementia, Greenland, extinctions, autism, new human organ, Nobel Prizes and so on. In addition, as usual, news, observances and opportunities. The first story is about human microevolution. So this evolution that is happening in human beings sees more people born without the wisdom teeth, you know, the extreme teeth. And also the people are born with an extra artery. So that's really interesting. The artery is in the forearm. So that supplies blood to the hand has become more prevalent in newborns since 19th century because we use the hands often for industrial purposes or tool making. We really don't have any clue why it is, the need for an extra artery. So probably we are using the hands quite often these days, comparing with our past, you know. So for example, we are writing, right? Maybe that is the reason that why we need an extra artery in our arms. So next story is about the face masks. You know, the face mask unlikely to cause overexposure to the carbon dioxide, even in the patients with lung disease. You might have heard lots of fake news about the mask wearing leads to something called hypercapnia, you know, or hypoxia. That is basically the oxygen is decreasing while carbon dioxide is increasing, hypercapnia, but it doesn't. The entire repertoire of all these, news are nothing but alternative facts or fake news. So don't trust on this. So we now have a solid proof that it is incorrect, even for those with the lung diseases, you know. So I've covered this topic many times in this channel. So one analogy that the fakers always say is about the fart. So because a fart can enter to your nose, you know, the stink. So just like that, the virus can also enter even if you wear the mask. No, that is not the case. And the fakers also say that carbon dioxide cannot exit. You know, that is the reason that we are actually getting the extreme hypercapnia. So that is incorrect. So just see the size of CO2 is its molecule. It's really, really small. So much, much larger than the coronavirus or any of the virus particle. You know, a good analogy would be the CO2 molecule is the size of a basketball. A virus is the size of a building. You see, a basketball versus a big building. There's a huge difference. And the view of the mask creates a space like a tennis court. You know, so that is the reason that CO2 can simply pass on, but the buildings cannot pass through the tennis court, so it can prevent it. You know, so that is the reason, especially if it is an aerosol. Our next story is about slow blinkering. You know, if you look at the cat's eye and if you blink your eyes very slowly, then you are actually conveying, you know, a message of the friendliness to your cat. You know, it really helps to convince the cats that you want to be friends. So it's a trick that you can do it. It's a curiosity-driven study by ethologists, the animal behavior specialists. And the next study is about mask again. So the men are more likely than the women to perceive face masks are infringing on their freedom. So many people complain that the mask, you know, if the government is insisting that masks should be worn on the public places like here in India. So people say that you are infringing on our freedom of movement. It's a personal choice, you know, many people say like that. So this kind of, protests are more likely to be coming from men than women. That is what the new study reveals. Next story is about tinnitus. The tinnitus is like ringing sound that you hear even when it's complete silence. You know, it's like pin drop silence and still you keep on hearing some kind of sound. It's basically, you know, it's a neuronal issue or it could be a psychological issue as well. So that disease is known as tinnitus. So the new study says that combining the sound with electrical stimulation of the tongue can significantly reduce the tinnitus. It's also commonly described as a ringing in the ear. That is what tinnitus is all about. So therapeutic effects can sustain up to 12 month post-treatment. So it is like a daycare treatment, you know. So then it can go on for next 12 months. So quite an interesting piece of study. So the next is about COVID-19 reinfection. So several confirmed cases of a COVID-19 reinfection has been emerged in the month of October. So 25-year-old men from the US and 42-year-old again in the US and 89-year-old lady died due to the COVID-19 reinfection in the Netherlands. So all these studies did a whole genome sequencing to affirm that it's basically, you know, the virus is basically the same virus is infecting again and again. So reinfection we cannot rule out. But the point is that what is it, you know, the percentage of this reinfection. So it's highly unlikely to be highly significant, you know, the reinfection. So majority of cases, reinfection doesn't happen at least for a few months. So vaccines are definitely going to be our main hope for the fight against COVID-19. Yet another study from the last month is that, you know, we have a proof of an explosion of a supernova that has, you know, perilously close to the Earth almost 2.5 million years ago. So the concentration of 53 manganese, so it's an isotope of manganese, and also the iron 60. So these two are the traces that's, you know, that shows about explosion of the supernova. So the geologists have measured the concentration of this 53 million, basically a study from Germany. And they confirmed that, you know, it is basically a huge supernova explosion that has completely darkened our atmosphere for many days. So this has happened pretty close in geological time scale, you see, 2 million years back. So the next study is about IUD, that is intrauterine devices, the contraceptive method. So back in 2009, Colorado, that is a US state, started a program to offer long-acting reversible contraceptives like IUDs to the low-income women. The initiative reduced births by approximately 20% among 15 to 19 year olds who lived near the clinics that were funded to offer the IUD. So that is a very interesting study. The efficacy of the IUDs, that is basically it's a reversible contraceptive, you know. So if you plan to have a baby, you can just remove it, the IUD. Here, usually in India, we call it as copper T. So here in India as well, the government is giving the IUDs free of charge, but not many are aware of it. And it has come kind of gone out of fashion. Nobody is actually getting these IUD implants. But IUDs are really effective, almost 99% efficacy. Next study is about a reopening, you know, after the COVID-19 lockdown. So on average, the number of excess COVID-19 cases per 100,000 residents in the US states reopening without mask is 10 times the number in states reopening with mask after 8 weeks. So that the masks really help to reduce, you know, the community transmission of COVID-19. So the key for reopening is insisting universal masking. So 50,000 excess deaths were prevented within 6 weeks in 13 states that implemented mask mandates prior to the reopening. So in the US, some states mandated the mask while other states did not. You know, the Republican states did not while Democratic states did. So those Democratic states that mandated the mask saw significant reduction in the death. You know, that's really a startling study. So the new study shows that the best way to express a gratitude, how can you say thank you to somebody who did a help to you? So the people who help you love to hear how their kind action met your needs. So that is what they want to know. For example, if they gave you a helping hand with your home chores, so you can always say that how much useful that, you know, that action had been, rather than saying that, you know, how costly that action is. Like, you know, you really did a tremendous work, you know, despite so and so. So that kind of cost kind of, you know, statements are not that effective. You should, you know, rather say that how their actions really met your needs. So that is what everybody wants to hear, you see. So the next study is again about the SARS-CoV-2. So the virus can survive up to 9 hours on human skin compared to the nearly 2 hours for the influenza type A virus. Maybe that is one reason why the viral infection is really, you know, conquering the present world. So it can survive quite long on the human skin. So this study is yet another proof that says that don't go in the public places, you know, sparsely clothed. So it's always better to wear the full sleeve cloth, and it's also better to take a bath after you return from exposing your skin to the public places, you know. So both were completely inactivated on the human skin within 15 seconds by ethanol. So hand washing or hand sanitizers do work. So the 9-hour survival of the SARS-CoV-2 on the human skin may increase the risk of contract transmission and supports hand hygiene. As you know, you can extend it to say that it's also better to take a bath, take a shower after you have been to a public place. People's attachment to the wilderness is linked to the fulfillment of basic psychological needs. Study finds, very interesting study. You know, attachment with the wilderness, that is basically the SISO way of the Finnish SISO concept or the Japanese. You know, most of these Western Europeans and Japanese, they do have this exposure to the wilderness imbibed in their society. So that, you know, we really have to go back in time, like our ancestors, how they used to live in the nature. So that another study is also kind of extension to the same study. Children whose outdoor play areas were transformed from a gravel yards to the mini forest showed improvement in the immune system within a month. That is what the new research says. So it's always better to let your kids play in mini forest or wilderness rather than on a proper park, you know, or the gravel playgrounds. It's always better to expose them for the wilderness. For example, go for a hike or camp in the wilderness, you know. So those kind of activities are really good. Next study is about dementia. The prevalence of the dementia in the countries where more than one language is spoken is 50% lower than those regions where the population uses only one language to communicate. So multilingualism could be a key to preventing the dementia. You know, if you speak more than one language, so your risk of developing this dementia is much lower. That is what the study says. So active bilingualism is an important predictor of the delay in the onset of symptoms of the mild cognitive impairment. So thanks to the multilingualism of the Indian population, so dementia is also quite low comparing with those countries that speak only one language. You know, so the new studies suggest that the people with the blood type O may have lower risk, that is 13% lower of the COVID-19 infection and reduced likelihood of the severe COVID-19 related outcomes, including the organ complications. So if they do get sick, no? So meanwhile, the individuals with type A and AB may have increased risk of severe clinical outcomes. So if you are of the rare type, that is O type, then chances are in your favor, you know, the COVID-19 severe infection, your probability of getting that kind of infection is much lower than like me, you know, type A or type B, AB, you know, not B, but AB or A. So that is what this, association study have revealed. So we also saw four studies that confirmed that the conservative in the US are more likely than liberals to endorse the conspiracy theories and expose the conspiratorial worldviews. Plus, extreme conservatives were significantly more likely to engage in the conspiratorial thinking than extreme liberals. So, right wing versus left wing, you know, it's more or less to do with the politics, political ideology, right? The conservatives are Republicans. So Republicans are far more likelier to believe in fake news and conspiracy theories than Democrats, you know, the liberal Democrats. So that is what the study says. So it's not just one study, but four studies. Next is that heightened susceptibility to misinformation linked to reduced mask wearing and social distancing. So if you believe in the fake news like hypercapnia or hypoxia link, you know, or extreme left-wing conspiracy theories that the mask wearing is a Western conspiracy, you know, so you don't wear the mask and poverty is more a rampant issue than mask. So, you know, get out of the mask. It's all Western, capitalist controversy. I have come across, I have covered this in my channel too, the extreme left-wing conspiracy theories. So all this misinformation, you know, if you are really susceptible to this sort of fake news and misinformation, then, you know, your likelihood of wearing mask and observing the physical distancing is much lower. That is what the study says. So the next story is again about COVID-19. Young adults aged 18 to 24 years demonstrate the earliest increases in the COVID-19 positivity, increasing 31 days before a US country is identified as a hotspot. This underscores the importance of the reducing transmission from the younger population to those at highest risk for severe illness and death. So, yeah, the young adults and even the schoolers, school-going children are the super spreaders. Unfortunately, this is the case, super spreaders of the COVID-19. So if we really want to curtail the transmission of COVID-19, we really have to target the children rather than adults. Next story is again about SARS-CoV-2. SARS-CoV-2 can live up to 28 days on surfaces such as mobile phone screens and ATMs, much longer than the previously thought. That is what the new Australian research has found. So this says that don't ever use somebody else's mobile phone. And also, if you ever go to the ATM, so after cash withdrawal, always sanitize your hand, you know. So ATM also means the cash counters in the supermarket. So if you ever go there, you know, so pay by wireless payment method. It's a lot more safer than using the currency. Even the currency notes can act as a vector, you know, formite for the transfer of the COVID-19 virus, that is SARS-CoV-2, and also the touch interface of your credit card. So it's always better to use Google Pay, for example. That's you know, wireless transfer, so no touch is required. So the next study is about Greenland. So Greenland could lose more ice this century than it has in 12,000 years. So the paper is also an answer to those who dismisses the ongoing effects of the climate change with the earth has always been changed, and the answer is not at this price. That is what the first author of the study, Campbell, says. You know, so Greenland ice is losing tremendously, friends. So in this rate, we are soon going to lose Greenland. Most probably, we'll be losing Greenland first, then Antarctica next. So that is what the doomsday prediction is by the climatologists, you know. So the next is about the symptoms of COVID-19. So one of the symptoms which has been overlooked is confusion. 53% people had this confusion. It was the most common neurologic manifestation in the patients with COVID-19, followed by impaired consciousness, that is 39%, agitation 31%, headache 16%, you know, ischemic strokes, that is 27%, were the most frequent neuroimaging finds. So it's all about neurological symptoms and what are the ramifications of the COVID-19. So confusion is one of the most common neurologic manifestation of the COVID-19. A new study finds that the right-wing authoritarians aren't very funny people, you know. So this is that funnier, more left-wing than the right-wing. Come on, what a study is that? But again, quite startling revelation. They aren't funny people. So 86% of people who tested positive for the COVID-19 during lockdown did not have the viral symptoms. You know, classical symptoms include cough, with fever, or and loss of taste or smell. The study included the data from representative population sample of 36,000 people living in England, Wales, and Northern Ireland. So the study is very revealing. 86% did not have any of these classical symptoms. So even if you have no symptoms, you know, so the study argues in favor of getting it tested. So quite an interesting study, isn't it? Next is about power plants. The new study cast doubt on the climate benefits of the natural gas power plants. The emissions and methane leaks from the new gas plants zero out the carbon dioxide cuts achieved from closing the coal plants, a peer-reviewed analysis has found. So many people say that if you shift from coal to the natural gas, you are being environmentally friendly, but this is not the case, you know. So the reason is that coal or natural gas, anyway, emissions are always there, CO2 emissions are always there. But of course, there is a definite advantage of this transformation to the this one, natural gas, is that the coal particle, the soot, microparticles while burning the coal, you know, that kind of contamination you can reduce or minimize to a vast extent if you shift to natural gas. So older adults with severe apathy or lack of interest in usual activities may have greater chance of developing dementia than people with few symptoms of apathy. That is what the new study says. So apathy may be a very early sign of dementia, and it can be valued with brief questionnaire. So if you ever come across somebody who is, you know, try to isolate themselves from all social contacts, then I think it's the time for you to help the person. You know, apathy is an early warning for the, you know, dementia. So this is a dimensionless second story that is being featured in this episode of Curiosity. Next story is about climate change. China's aggressive policy of planting trees is likely playing a significant role in tempering its climate impact. So it's a good news that the Chinese government is aggressively planting the trees throughout the China. So it has got a positive impact. So that is what the study says. The new paper shows that restoring 15% of the land previously converted for human use could avoid 60% of the expected species extinctions and sequester 30% of the total increase in the atmospheric CO2 since the Industrial Revolution. So it can sequester, means it can it can absorb the 30% of the total increase if you convert just 15% of the converted land back to the wilderness. So that is what the study says. So what is the converted land means? Most of these converted lands are agricultural fields, farmlands. So if you convert the farmlands to mini forest, again, second story to, in this month episode of Curiosity, we are covering about the mini forest. So letting migratory birds come in, if you actually convert the farmland to the mini forest and if you let these migratory birds come in, that can boom the local tourism too. So it is a revenue generator for the farmers. They are not going to be losers, if you convert a small patch of their farmland to the mini forest. So this is a great revelation that this study has revealed. So first of its kind global survey shows the initial phase of the COVID-19 lockdown dramatically altered our personal habits, including mine, I'm sure yours too. Overall healthy eating increased because we ate out less frequently. So we are not more eating out regularly, but we snacked more. That is what, at home, if you're staying, we tend to snack a lot more. So we got less exercise and we went to bed later and slept more poorly. These are the revelations of this global survey. So our sleep quality has deteriorated. That is very strange. Earlier in the Curiosity, I covered that the sleep quality has increased. That is what the people believe in, because these nightmares, people are often saying about they have seen so and so nightmares because of this undisrupted sleep, especially in the early morning sleep, that leads to the dream that we can recollect, isn't it? Nightmares. Next story is about autism. Autism is considered as a disorder of the brain, but the new study suggests that peripheral nervous system, the nerves that control our sense of touch, pain and other sensation may play a role as well. So it's not just the brain, but also the peripheral nervous system. For example, your nerves on your face has got lots of nerves, and also your fingertips. So those nerves also play a key role on the development of the autism. So next story is about sex. Safe sex or risky romance? So we have got two choices, risky romance or safe sex. That is what the conundrum of the young adult. The study says that young adults do make a rational choice, so study has found that the young adults, contrary to how they are sometimes portrayed in the media, tend to make highly rational decisions when it comes to selecting potential romantic partners. So it's not that they always indulge in the unsafe sex, for example, but that is not what this study says. So even majority of the young adults do take rational decisions when it comes with romance and sex. Next story of the month is about schooling. The religious schooling hampers economic development and innovation. That is what it says. So if you teach religion in school, then those areas, economic development and innovation, are much, much lesser. So areas of France with religious schooling during late 19th century and early 20th century were slow to adopt technical curriculum, focusing instead on the religious content in the curricula, hampering the economic development. So if you, if your schooling is paying more and more attention to the religious curricula, then chances are high that the innovation and economic development in those areas are going to be much more lesser. So maybe this study might throw a light on potential schools where you may want your ward to be sent. So which school to choose for your children, religious school or non-religious school. So the study argues in favor of non-religious school for better fostering of the innovation. The research shows that compensating employees based on their accomplishment rather than on the hours worked produces better results. So compensating the employees only based upon the hours like factory workers, that is not a good option. But based on the accomplishment, what did you do? Especially this is true in academia, you know, or the science and technology industries, or you know, those kind of job sector. What exactly you did, what kind of research, what kind of things that you produce, research or products or patents. So those kind of you know, the benchmarks are much more better, the yardsticks are better than looking at the hours that you were present in the workplace. When organizations with a mix of high to low performing employees base rewards on hours worked, all employees see compensation as unfair and they end up putting less effort. That is what they discovered. Well, if you ask me what kind of job is the best, my answer would be doable amount of work with necessary resources and with clear goals that actually aligns with my identity. You know, so the resources, I'm not starved of the resources, and you know, the amount of work is also doable, you know, and of course with clear goals, that goal is aligning with my identity. For example, if my identity, of course my identity is a science communicator, and if my job allow me to communicate the sciences, you know, then that is a perfect job. You know, it doesn't matter that how long you work for that. Coming to the news from October of 2020. So first is COVID-19 treatment and vaccine updates. So first is treatments. We now have the fifth candidates at the phase 3 clinical trial. By the way, phase 3 is the last clinical trial for 1, 2 and 3. So after clinical trial, that phase 3, then you might get the approval from the FDA. So till last month, it was only 4, but now new entrant is Vir Biotechnology. You know, their antibody based you know, the therapeutics also entered the phase 3 clinical trials. And another story from the last week is about Remdesivir by the Gilead Life Sciences. So Gilead's Remdesivir got limited FDA approval. So those COVID-19 patients in the US which are admitted can get Remdesivir, you know, the injections. Experiment, it's basically an approval, but it's a limited approval. That itself is a big thing. So in that sense, Remdesivir becomes the first ever drug which gets the FDA approval against COVID-19. So we have two candidate phase 2 clinical trial, third is Multistem and Merck EIDD-2801, you know, so no progress from the last month. So now coming to the vaccines, we now have four candidates at phase 3 clinical trial. The new entrant in the last month is Novavax. So Novavax vaccine candidate, you know, so that has also entered into the phase 3 clinical trial. And we also have two candidates at phase 2 clinical trials, Sinovac and CanSino Biologics. So last month also saw a very, you know, much quoted study on Indian supermodel. You know, so that is the supermodel is basically a paper published in Indian Journal of Medical Research, ICMR Journal, Indian Journal of Medical Research by a group of scientists from India. So the authors claim that almost half of Indians will have COVID-19 infection by, you know, February 2021. So the study did not directly say anything about herd immunity, but indirectly the study clearly says that herd immunity is our final solace. You know, and because of the herd immunity, you know, the COVID-19 infection will definitely go extremely down by February. You know, we can actually find by 2021 February, India will be out of, you know, COVID-19, or India, the COVID-19 situation in India will be under control. That is what the study says. Of course, it's a modeling based study, and many criticisms have been arised from the dates of this Starlink study publication. And many says that the modeling is completely inaccurate. You know, many famous mathematical modelers say that the study did not consider so and so, you know, factors, the parameters. And it's too flexible model that they used, you know. So this is a paper that has recently been published a few days back in the journal Science. Herd immunity, India still has a long way to go. That is what the scientists say. I mean, it's an opinion article or a news article, and it shows the quotes from different scientists working in the field of mathematical modeling that is saying that this Indian supermodel is highly inaccurate. So, molecular water detected for the first time at the sunlit surface of the moon by the NASA. That is a very important development from the last month. You know, we have the solid proof, the first proof that water is present in the surface, sunlit surface of the moon. Well, remember that India's own lunar mission, the Chandrayaan, also did the same conclusion. I mean, it's a work with the NASA, if I remember it right. So, conclusion that there is water on the lunar surface. So, this study is specifically looked on the sunlit, not the other side, the dark side of the moon, but this is on the sunlit side of the moon. They found the molecular water, not a proxy of the water. You know, molecular water is the real water. And scientists also discovered that Jupiter's moon Io has gaseous atmosphere and hundreds of active volcanoes. What is study, you know, what the research says. So hundreds of active volcanoes are present in Io. Io is the moon, you know, the natural satellite of the Jupiter. Next is about the new organ in our throat, human throat. Scientists, these are the scientists from the Netherlands. They discover a new organ in the human throat while studying prostate cancer. And they named the organ as tubarial salivary glands, that is just on the top of you know, the neck region. So it's very interesting. So see the power of science. We still don't know about our human body, right? The new organs are being discovered. So air quality sharply deteriorates all around North India. Stubble burning intensifies. That is what is happening in this region where I'm living, here in Punjab or anywhere in the North India. Stubble burning gets intensified post-harvest season, and because of that, the air quality sharply deteriorates. And especially if you are fond of outdoor activities, and also if you ride cycle a lot like me, then this season is really bad for you, you know. And yet another study reveals that air pollution has led to 116,000 infant death in India in 2019 alone. So all these are preventable, you know. So if we minimize this stubble burning alone, we could have prevented the death of the infants. 116,000, a significant number of the infant deaths, you know. So CSIR along with Tata Group announces Feluda, the new COVID-19 test that works on the CRISPR-Cas9. So that is also a very interesting development in the last month. Although they're saying that it's going to be very cheap, you know. CRISPR-Cas9, this is the first test that actually works on the CRISPR-Cas9 technology, the technology that has won this year's Nobel Prize, right? And though it is the new one, and they claim that it's really cheap, around 80 rupees per test or so, but it hasn't hit the market yet. You know, there are several roadblocks, and before that it can actually hit the market. So another very important sad story from the last month is that legendary skeptic, the American skeptic and magician who debunked many of the paranormal claims, James Randi, passes away aged 92 years. So James Randi, I'm a big fan of James Randi. He's an amazing skeptic. So James Randi even released a very interesting prize money, you know. If you can prove any of the paranormal or miraculous things happening in the nature, then you know they can they will give you the prize money of $1 million, and the money is still there. Nobody even claimed, you know. They can simply speak on the everyday the miracle and thing and mysteries, but if you can really prove any of the miracles, you know, you can earn. The money is still available. In case you can prove any of these miracles, the existence of the miracle, you can get the James Randi's prize money. He is of James Randi, and this video I have actually linked up. You know, it's about the homeopathy quackery and the fraud by James Randi. One of the well-watched video of the James Randi I have linked up in the show notes of this episode. Please have a look. I'm going to miss him a lot, tremendously. James Randi has been amazing skeptic of 20th century. And last month also saw announcement of Nobel Prizes from Stockholm. So Nobel Prizes of 2020, the physics were awarded to Roger Penrose, Reinhard Genzel and Andrea Ghez. The Penrose got it for the discovery that the black hole formation is a robust prediction of the general theory of relativity, the Einstein's theory. And Genzel got his Nobel Prize for the discovery of the supermassive compact object at the center of our galaxy, the Milky Way. So he found, you know, the black hole. And Andrea Ghez, Andrea is the woman who, you know, it's very rare to have the women winning physics Nobel. So for the discovery of supermassive compact object at the center of our galaxy. So both Genzel and Ghez got the award for, you know, the black hole in the Milky Way, the center of Milky Way. Penrose is an American citizen. Genzel is a German citizen, while Ghez is an American citizen. For the chemistry, it is Emmanuel Charpentier and Jennifer A. Doudna. So these scientists, actually their work is on molecular biology, though the award is in chemistry, for the development of a method of genome editing. So this, their method is nowadays known as CRISPR-Cas9 method of editing the genome. You know, so it is a really effective way to edit the genome. Charpentier is a French citizen, while Doudna is an American citizen. Coming to Nobel Prize for Physiology or Medicine, award to three scientists: Harvey J. Alter, Michael Houghton, and Charles M. Rice, for the discovery of hepatitis C virus. All these three scientists were crucial in discovering the virus, you know, the virus behind the transmission of the hepatitis C infection, so HCV virus. So they are from US, UK, and US. So most of these Nobel Prizes are going to the US these days, isn't it? So for literature, this also went to the American poet, Lousy Gluck. So for her unmistakable poetic voice with austere beauty that makes individual existence universal. And for the Peace Prize, it went to the World Food Program for its effort to combat world hunger, for its contribution for bettering conditions for the peace in conflict-affected areas, for acting as driving force in efforts to prevent the use of hunger as a weapon of war and conflict. And Nobel Prize for Economics also went to Diofrom, US. Paul R. Milgrom and Robert B. Wilson for, you know, the improvements to auction theory and inventions of the new auction format. So auctioning is nowadays very commonly used practice by economists, you know, the policymakers, and it's basically a macroeconomic theory of this auctioning. So though the award went to these two people who are behind the auctioning in economics, so one of the classic example of this auctioning happened here in India, you know, 4G and 3G, you know, the telecommunication auction. So it went terribly wrong. So auction didn't work at all. So, although the award went for their, you know, startling revelation of this auctioning, but somehow that auctioning was an utter failure here in India. Last month also saw a very interesting news, alarming news in the BBC. September was the world's hottest on record. So, you know, the hottest, the world record keep on, you know, we are actually keep on breaking as days goes by because of the climate change, because the global warming, you see. And the COVID-19 lockdown didn't do much on the climate change. That is a sad reality, you see. So there is the September had been the hottest month on record. You know, that is a very, very sad state of affairs. And at the same time, this is yesterday's news that Delhi records the coldest October in 58 years. That is what the weather department has said. So, you know, just by reading this news, don't be in an impression that the climate change is not happening here in North India. No, it's not the case. The climate change ramification is that the winters are getting extremely cold while summers are getting extremely warm. And the summer months are, you know, going to be expanding. Winter months are going to be lessening. And also extreme weather fluctuations like flash floods. Those are the ramifications of climate change. So this news also attests that the climate is changing. Globe is warming. That is the reason that Delhi records the coldest in October in 58 years, friends. So climate change is real. Coming to observances of the next month, that is the month of November. So in the month of November, what are the observances? The UN observances. The 5th of November is World Tsunami Awareness Day. 6th is International Day for Preventing the Exploitation of the Environment in War and Armed Conflict. 10th is World Science Day for Peace and Development, a very important day for the viewers of my channel and this the program Curiosity. 2020 theme of the World Science Day is Science for and with Society. More on this later. 14th is World Diabetes Day. 19th is World Toilet Day and World Philosophy Day. 20th is World Children's Day. 25th is International Day for Elimination of Violence Against Women. Coming to the World Science Day, this, you know, the purpose of this UN World Science Day for Peace and Development are strengthen the public awareness of the role of science for peaceful and sustainable societies, promote the national and international solidarity for shared science between countries, renew national and international commitment for the use of science for the benefit of societies, and draw attention to the challenges faced by science in raising support for scientific endeavor. You may plan some good activities during the World Science Day celebrations on 10th November. So coming to astronomy related observances, 10th is the Mercury at its greatest in western elongation, 11th to 12th is Northern Taurus meteor shower, 13th is the close approach of the Moon and Venus, 16th to 17th is Leonids meteor shower. See, so this month is also kind of good for those who are interested to spot the meteors, you know, asteroids, just like the month of October that we covered earlier. So 19th is the close approach of the Moon, Jupiter and Saturn. 25 is the close approach of the Moon and Mars. 28th is the peak of November Orionids meteor shower. And 30th is the penumbral lunar eclipse. So basically the penumbral means Earth's shadow falls onto the Moon. Of course, the lunar eclipse is always like that. But penumbral means it's not complete. It's a partial lunar eclipse visible in, you know, the Asian countries, especially in the East Asian countries. Coming to opportunities, call for proposal for DBT initiative for chemical ecology of Northeast region, that is NER of India, 16th November is the deadline. DBT research associateship, 15th November is the deadline. And this year they also have a special research associateship for candidates from Northeast region of India. DBT call for proposals for COVID-19 therapeutics, 31st November is the deadline. Sorry, this is a mistake. It's not October, it's November. Ramalingaswamy Reentry Fellowship 2021, the deadline is 15th November. So they have extended the deadline. So you can still apply if you haven't applied yet. Tata Innovation Fellowship for 2021 is 15th November is the deadline. And Summer Research Fellowship Program in the year of 2021 for students and teachers, 30th November is the deadline. And that's it for this episode of the Curiosity, the November episode. I hope you like this science show. If you like this show, please click the thumbs up, share it in your groups, and do subscribe to my channel. I will see you soon in my next video. Goodbye.